Hi. Hi. Thank you for being here.
Hi, I don't think I know you.
Beth, I'm Kelly Heath.
Kelly, nice to meet you.
Yeah, I work up in the in Augusta at the Department of Ed for adult education.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
It's nice
That's
to meet
great.
You too.
Cool. Are you connected with the program?
Yeah, well, I work for adult education. This program, I've taken a class or two.
Nice.
But not for my master's or anything.
Right.
But I see I work with adult ed directors.
That's awesome.
That this program has graduated. They're our best directors.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
Oh, that's
people.
Cool to know.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, so
that's
it's
great.
Nice to meet you.
It's nice to meet you as well. Thanks for being here.
Yeah, no
great.
Worries.
Great, great, great.
Hi.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
My other half is in a meeting. She'll be in here in a minute.
Oh, cool. Awesome.
Just going to Google hang up in the car.
Awesome.
No, no.
Yeah. It's all good.
Excited.
Yeah.
I can be.
Thank you. Thank you for being here.
I live in Hollis.
Yeah.
I could just come
Thank you.
Knock your breath.
I do.
You've got your water right here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I do.
I'll maybe one or two more minutes?
Yes. Hey, hi, guys. Thanks for being here. Appreciate
Among
it.
Among the faithful in the committee.
Brilliant times.
Okay, you're good. Wow.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah,
awesome. Thanks. Yeah. Cool. All right. Thanks. Appreciate it. All right.
Just because you're telling me to.
So take a breath.
Yeah, thanks.
That was a good meeting upstairs.
Oh, good.
That was a good meeting.
Good.
I was impressed with the turnout in the department. I give this big song and dance to you, they don't show up. And almost all of them showed up.
That's cool. Cool. Good people.
Good people.
Really
yeah.
good people.
You got a few friends in this room.
Mm-hmm.
Some of you folks want to get a better view of the PowerPoint. This room is a table, but you're fine there, too. I'm not going to force any of them. So,
yes, sir.
This isn't really your dissertation. A little bit based on your dissertation.
I have one piece in it, but it's not at all.
Okay.
But in the presentation, I mention it.
Hey.
Okay. Good. Because I think in one case, somebody was kind of working out of her dissertation. You know,
okay.
So you're not. You've graduated from your dissertation.
Absolutely. Still influences me, though. I'm not. Am I on?
Oh. You're on.
Okay.
Cool.
Thank you. Oh, I'm standing.
Because we want to make sure you're on camera.
Absolutely.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. My name is Mike Brady, and I teach in the Adult and Higher Education program, and I have this really weird situation where I'm actually chairing the search committee to replace myself. So we have a wonderful potential replacement here today, whose name is Beth Higgins, and I don't think she's a stranger to many people in this room. I do also want to welcome people from cyberspace. We have people all across the state of Maine, and at least the last two times, somebody from Northwestern University in Chicago who's taking part in this process. And I'm going to ask everybody, those of you who are here in person, and those of you who are watching this on the YouTube streaming, to please get feedback to me ASAP, because we're going to be meeting very shortly after today, the search committee. This is the third of three finalist presentations. And so timing is important with your feedback. So that being said, I'm going to ask Kim to say a little bit about the chat function. But I also want to say that Beth Higgins' topic, and it's right there, connecting theory with professional practice. So, and Kim is going to say it.
Thank you. Okay, so for you that are out there live streaming, if you have the screen on full, you can't necessarily see the chat feature, but otherwise, if you have it a little bit minimized, you can see the chat feature. It's on the right-hand side. Just chat to me. And I can take the question and then relay it to Beth, who can answer your question. So don't hesitate to use it. We've used it the last couple of presentations, and it works really great. Okay.
Awesome.
Beth.
Great. Thank you so much. Well, welcome, everybody. Thank you so very, very much for being here. It makes me kind of want to cry right now. So I'm very excited to be part of the finalists group, and I appreciate you being interested in coming here and being part of the future of the program. So today, I'm going to chat a little bit about the connection of theory to professional practice. And I don't know about you, but sometimes when people say the word theory, my heart pounds, sometimes with nervousness and sometimes with going, oh, really? Are we really going to do that? So I don't know if you folks feel the same way. If you do, just, you know, do something like this. And distance folks, thank you very much for being here with us. And I'm sorry that I can't see your face, but I'm looking forward to your questions. So my name is Beth Higgins, as you heard, and I am very passionate about this program. I know personally how it can change lives. I'm a graduate of the program, and it has changed my life and how I perceive learning and how I actually act as a human being. So I'm delighted to be here. So let's begin. So let's talk about how theory actually is connected to our professional practice. And that's a professional practice, whether you are a teacher, whether you are an administrator, whether you are a student, whoever you are, you have a professional practice that you interact with people every day, but that you form yourself around this professional practice. So in higher education, it's and I promise I will not, we are in a very complex organization, but I would suggest that no matter where we work, and no matter where we volunteer, we are in the center of complex organizations, especially where the world is going now. So this is a picture of higher education. And as you can see, there are many different facets to higher education. And as we as educators, no matter if you're in the classroom or outside the classroom, we have to work through all of this stuff, no matter where we are. But all of this stuff can be influenced by theory and can be connected to theory. So I welcome you as we go through this presentation and we have a short discussion around this, that you see yourself in the complexity, but also how theory can help you understand that complexity that much more. So what is the purpose of theory? It's always interesting to me to figure that out. Like when I first started learning about theory, and at first I was not passionate about it. I was like, oh, here we go again. Here's a theory. Let's learn more about it. But then when I started looking at it in a way that it could help educate me, it was much more helpful. So theory can help us understand the total picture. But it can also help us understand and explain and describe and especially predict what can happen. So if we take a look at a theory of change or a theory around grief, there's a certain pattern to that. Sometimes we're stunned and we're shocked about the change or the loss of something. And as we go through it, we can start describing and explaining through that lens of theory. We also can predict what happens in the end, that maybe through that loss, we'll be frustrated, we'll have a sense of loneliness, but then you come to terms with something, and then you start growing at a different level of understanding and acceptance. So we can predict that happening through that lens of theory. And we can also influence outcomes. So if we're working with a student and we know that they're going through a time of change, we can predict what might be happening with them next. And we can actually change the way that we work with that student depending on what we're predicting might happen. And then we can also assess our practice. So whatever we do, we should be assessing practice anyways, right? So that we can learn from where we've been and that we can change our practice in a way that is with educated change and data, but we can take that theory and use it as a way to assess our practice. And also through that, we can identify gaps in either the literature or the research that we can fill and create more new knowledge and new options for practitioners to read about in the literature. So if we take a look at this slide where it's highlighting two aspects of higher education, and for this instance, the CAS Standards, which is the Council for Advancement of Standards, is an organization, a consortium of over 40 different areas within higher education. And representatives from these organizations, national and global organizations, have gotten together to develop particular practices, standards for our practice that help guide us what's appropriate and what might not be appropriate. But how do we become the best in our professional practice? So in higher education, these areas cover things like financial aid, things like advising, tutoring, developmental education. There are set practices and standards for these practices. We at USM are going through a huge change with career. Allie's here from career. And they, by using the Council for the Advancement of Standards, we're able to look at that and make appropriate changes and decisions around that. We did the same in advising. And then if we look at that and what the council has done is they actually have gone out and stated that it's imperative that these programs and these areas actually use theory to guide their practices. They've stated that. So that's an important aspect of what we do as practitioners to ensure that we follow those standards. They've also stated that the programs within that, so it could be financial aid, it could be, I'll use advising as in the example, that there are certain areas that we must be guided by the knowledge and learning and development for students. So we need to keep that as a priority. And then for NACADA, which is the Global Community for Academic Advising, they too believe that theory is important. And they have stated it, if you go to any of the national sessions that they offer, either online or in person, they state that it's important, it's our responsibility to contribute to the field and ensure that we are using and developing theory and new knowledge, so much so that they've designed a whole center for research. And from that, new theories will be developed and old theories will be tweaked. They also are committed to helping others learn. So that center of research is actually also being leaned on so that practitioners can request help and get guidance from the national or international organization in order to help the professional practice. So this theory to practice model, I love this for two reasons. One, it gives us a model to work off from when we're looking at how do we connect and how do we bring a theory into practice. Reason and Kimball, and just so that you know, Kimball in this instance is Zeke Kimball, who is a graduate of the Adult and Higher Education Program. Yes, good, huh? Zeke, yeah. Zeke Kimball. He's a professor at UMass Amherst and is doing some phenomenal work around theory to practice. And he developed this model which walks us through as practitioners that we have this working knowledge of the theory. So there is the theory itself where we can sit with it and read it, any particular theory. There's hundreds, probably thousands of theories out there. And we know about the theory. Then we have to take the institutional context or the organizational context and look at that. So how, in higher ed, it's what does the institution look like? Is it undergraduate only? Is it graduate only? Is it online only? What creates that institutional context? What Carnegie classification is it? who are our students? So all of that comes into effect and to actually relate to how we utilize theory. Because then the next step is this informal theory. We have these practitioners who have the knowledge, but then because of their own beliefs and values, they start tweaking it in a way using the environment, the institutional context, and then creating this working theory, which is called the informal theory, where that meaning-making happens. And then they have action. So we use that knowledge and that working theory to create this action in these decisions that we have made in working with students or with employees or with clients. And then these arrows represent how we use the action to actually do some reflecting. So there's this practice, this action piece, and we also use it for assessment. So assessing what we do as well. So this is a model that we can use on a daily basis when working through how we connect theory and practice. So how does theory help? How does it help us as practitioners? Well, it provides this lens. So I always think about it, and I like glasses, and when I go to the eyeglass store, I like to pick up all these little different glasses and put them on and say, okay, how do I look in this one? Well, if they had different lenses on them, they would actually make me see in different ways. Well, that's what theory does. It allows for an interpretive lens to actually help us see things in a different way. But it also guides us through this, through different aspects of our work, whether it's problem solving, specific actions, also reflection and planning. So as we work through, and I'll walk you through a couple of examples, theory is actually here to help us, not to hinder us, but to help us through and guiding us through our professional practice. So let's look at the interpretive lens, hey? And we interpret things in different ways depending on what pair of glasses or what theory we are actually looking through. So when I speak with students, and I just had a conversation last week with a faculty member and a student who wanted to do a research project around advising. And we were talking about, well, what lens of theory are you going to use? And the student is actually looking at using uncertainty theory. So when she's doing her research, she'll use that uncertainty theory to look through as she looks at her data that she gathers through her research project. And her specific research project is going to be the uncertainty of undergraduate students as they enter into the institution. It would be really cool if we did the same type of research as for graduate students as well, because my understanding, including my personal experience, is that there is this uncertainty that happens as we enter into graduate level learning. But here are all the different things that we can actually interpret with the lens. So it's individuals, it's situations, it's groups, it's subgroups. So we can use the interpretive lens to look at all these different ways within our working environment and our learning environment to then gather a different perspective depending on what we're looking at. I don't know if anybody knows JD, but JD, I don't know him personally, but I know him through this quote, and I know plenty of graduate students who use this quote, because as we use theory to guide us through problem solving, he's very well known for stating, when you can't figure it out, turn to theory for help. So it's really important for me as a practitioner that if I can't figure it out, and with the people that surround me, if we can't figure it out, how can we use theory as a lens to help us look at things? So whether it's a student who's transitioning in, or maybe it's an advising situation, or maybe for me it's a supervisory situation that I might need help with, And I might not need the help of another professional, I might need just help of a different perspective. And theory can help me do that. So here's an example of a research problem that is of that I hold actually very close to my heart, because it's my own personal research around relationships within the advising context. When I was looking at advising as a whole, I knew I wanted to do a piece of research and I wanted to fill a gap in the literature. But what I figured out is that the literature in advising talks about the importance of the relationship that a faculty member has with a student or with a professional advisor that has with a student. It is all over the place in the literature. But there's not a lot of data and not a lot of research around it. Because, you know, not everybody wants to talk about relationships, and I get that. And relationships are complicated, and I understand that. But how do we dig deeper into that so that we understand? And theory can help us out in identifying that. There truly was a gap in the literature, but also within that gap was that nobody was really talking about how advisors could influence that relationship. And I wanted to take on that challenge and figure that out. So what I did is I used Hildegard Peplau's interpersonal relations theory. As one of my friends who I talk about this theory a lot, and she has a nickname, Hildegard, as Hildy. She goes, good old Hildy. Peplau was actually a nurse, and this is a nursing theory. Hildegard Peplau actually changed the way that the medical profession looks at nursing. They're not just transactional, but it's a relational experience. And because of her research, nursing actually has transformed itself over the years to be a relational type of experience that patients experience, but also nurses. So I took this theory, and I took the problem, and I put the theory in front of the problem and gathered data. I did interviews with 20 people. It was a multiple case study. And then I, for the advising pairs, I put the data together so that it was a case study, so 10 case studies. And as I looked at the data, through this theory, which starts out as getting acquainted, so the nurse and the patient gets acquainted, they try to figure each other out, they don't know if they could trust each other, and then it increases over time, so then there's this recognition that the patient has for needing help. There's this kind of, I don't want to give up my dependence, but maybe I do want independence. So there's some human factors that come into play. Goals are identified. And then the next step is where the relationship starts to grow. And it starts to really be something of trust. And then in the end, the fourth stage is where there's a peak in the learning experience of the patient. But also there's a readiness to actually let go of that dependence on it. And what I discovered through looking at the data of these advising pairs was that the same thing was happening in advising as happened with the nurse-patient relationship. So through that, what I discovered and built was this advisor fit model. And what happens is that the authenticity of the advisor is what kicks off the advising relationship. It's the advisor that brings their presence into the relationship, their true core, I'm here, I am being, you can see me. And that allows the student to start sharing their true self, which then allows both of them to start this trusting relationship. And this really cool environmental thing starts to happen, and knowledge and understanding of each other, and seeing themselves as trusting individuals, but also there becomes this appreciation for each other. And then here is where there's a lot of conversation that happens and meaning making that is discovered. And then once the faculty member starts gaining understanding and confidence in the student feels that as well. They feel that energy, that connection with the faculty advisor, and they build their own self-confidence around that component. And that is when the faculty advisor says, okay, I might put my name on you. I think I can. I think I can trust you with doing research with me. I think I can trust you with referring you to somebody that I have a relationship with for an internship. And then as time goes on, the student becomes independent. So if we look at Peplau's interpersonal relations theory, the different stages, we also see that there's an increase in connectedness over time. And that's how the relationship is built. So using that Peplau's interrelation theory as the lens, I could look at the data in a different way. And had I used a different theory, you wouldn't probably see this. You would see something else. The data is still good. It's just that that's not how I was looking at the data to inform the end. So let's take a look at how theory guides reflection. So think about being in that eyeglass store, throwing on all those glasses and reflecting upon something. It could be an interaction you had, a decision that you made, a relationship that you have, something, a program that you developed and implemented. It could be an advising session you just had. It could be a phone call that you just had. It's something. It could be a course that you designed. It could be a course that you implemented, but you're reflecting upon it. So in this example, I used Mesereau's transformative, I always want to call it transformational, a transformative learning theory. So as this theory states, there's some sort of transformative learning that happens because of this reflection, but there's a disorienting event that happens. And then there's an assessment that goes on, and then exploration of options and implementation. And for this example, I wanted to look at something that I was, and Libby Bishkoff too, was very intimately involved in, and that was the change of the academic advising model here at the University of Southern Maine. So 2 years ago, we, the institutional leadership, deemed that the dual advising model was the way to go. So we knew we had to do that model. We just didn't know what exactly what it would look like here at the university. That declaration of that model change was the disorienting event for this institution. Usually this theory is used for individual transformative learning. But as I'm looking at this in a reflective way, through this lens, I'm looking at the organizational change that happened and what is the transformative learning that happened through that process. To do the assessment, we had an advising task force that was put together, and we dug through all kinds of data, talked to a number of different people, but really gathered information that was available to us, both nationally and locally. And then what we did is we said, okay, what are all our options? Where are we? How are we going to design a plan? And we also had to, much like what this is saying here, exploration of all the options and plans. That means we also talked to national experts in advising. So we had the executive director of the national organization come in, and we sat around a table like this, and we talked, and looking at the different options. And what we came up with was that advising, the professional advising component needed to move to academic affairs, and that was the best thing for this institution, connecting it to academic affairs. We knew that information was really, really important, the clarity of that, and students were screaming for that. They were also screaming for accessible advisors. They wanted to believe that their advisors were at their fingertips to a certain extent, but they were accessible and that they knew them and they cared about them and that they were responsive. And then there needed to be some sort of advising community, because before it was whatever major a student was depended on what the advising experience was. But this would create an advising community if we did it right. And then as we started to go into the implementation phase, the institution came up with the service values. So many of you may have already heard student first every day. So, or student focused every day rather. And that's something that the advising community started to embrace. And along with that is the student service values of integrity responsiveness and care. And that was an important aspect as well. And then academic affairs adopted advising, so advising was moved to academic affairs, and the link to that was very important, and we went on an advising roadshow. So the provost, myself, and professional advisors and faculty in each department met and talked about the value of advising and what the advising needs were, and also it set the stage. There was a faculty advising liaison program that was connected to academic advisors so that we could start building relationships with faculty partners and professional advising partners. There's a professional development plan. We upset the onboarding of new students to be responsive to this responsiveness and care and accessibility and information. And we also made the information accessible to all, not just students, not just advisors, but everyone. And this is not perfect. It's still a work in progress. But the transformative learning component that came out of this was that the advising was seen and believed to be as part of teaching. It's an extension of teaching. No longer is there quite the questioning that's going on, but it was an embrace of that. And in the center of teaching, as you all know, is student learning. So that's what this component of, when I was reflecting on this, this is what happened within that lens of theory. So let's keep on moving. Let's look at how theory guides planning. Are you all still with me? All right. My online distant people still with me? Okay. Nobody disappeared.
No.
Okay.
It's just grown.
That's good. We're growing and growing. Thank you, everybody. So let's take a look at how theory guides planning. We could be planning courses, programs, professional development. There's all kinds of things that we plan, right? All kinds. And then planning can happen in different ways. It can happen with just one singular person that puts out a plan or designs something, or it could be a group of folks. But if we use theory to guide us, that helps us design the plan. So this is an example. So a couple of years ago, I was asked to design and implement the HRD 554 Foundations of Academic Advising. I was very excited about that. I had really never taught and never designed a course on the graduate level. And Mike said, yes, you can do that. I believe in you. Go off and do. So I did. So what I did was that I chose the Dale's Cone of Learning and Bloom's Taxonomy. As we know, is when we're designing courses, the most important thing is that we capture the engagement of students, but we also want to make sure that they learn at the highest mark, right? And that they're not just remembering and they're repeating, but they actually can see themselves as that practitioner taking the learning and implementing it into something in their lives, so that they can apply their learning immediately. That's very important. So as I looked at the cone of learning, oh my goodness, I didn't really realize this, although I know I don't remember everything that I read, but after 2 weeks, if I read something, I only remember 10%. That made me a little nervous. But then, as I worked through the cone of learning, if I'm doing something and if I'm saying something, chances are I'm going to remember 90% of that. And then in Bloom's taxonomy, did I just want students to remember and to understand? Probably not. I really wanted them to create and apply and analyze so that they got the most out of this learning experience that I possibly could give them and provide them. So with that, I created the course. And so I said to myself, okay, how am I going to pull this off so that they're creating, analyzing, and doing and saying all in this online environment? And one of the things that was important to me is that engagement, and it's also important to our adult learners. They want to be engaged in the process. And Stacy can tell us whether or not she was engaged. She was in this process, so you can tell me if it worked or not. But these folks in this class are learning everything. They're learning about the approaches to advising, the different models, they're reading literature. There are some advisors that never get to read all the literature that they do in 7 weeks within their entire time. So it's pretty aggressive as far as really diving into the literature. And as Stacy's saying, doing this, we know it's true. But how in the heck was I going to get them to apply this knowledge and to analyze and to create? So one of the very last papers that students are required to write is a paper where they choose a student and they have to embrace this student. It's a case study. Embrace everything that is going on in the students' lives. And there's multiple students that they can choose from. And then they have to be the student's advisor and create this long and short-term advising plan, which means they really have to understand the student, evaluate what the student's going through, do an analysis of that, look at the different opportunities that they can provide for learning for the student, and create an advising plan. And then so that they're doing there, now they have to say, so they say through the written word within the paper, but they also say by sharing that information in the discussion board. And it creates this discussion because when you're talking about people and that they care about because they've just adopted the student, and they're pretty creative, they're actually engaging in the process of advising without technically advising. My hope is to someday figure out a way that we can make it so that it's actually really is advising. But that is a way that I used these theories to actually make a difference in the classroom environment for students. And then the last area, theory guides action. So we do a lot of action-oriented things in our lives as educators. I supervise, there's plenty of us here that supervise. We advise, we teach, we facilitate. There are a bunch of things that we are doing, right? And you could keep on adding to this list. But how does theory guide us through this? And through different ways. So this is Sanford's challenge and support theory. And what Sanford has done is showcase that there needs to be a balance between challenge and support. If we support students too much, they might just dribble away, like I'm not engaged, I don't have to do anything, I just have to be. But if we challenge them too much, it might be too much, and they might do the fight or flight and run. So how do we balance that in a way? And part of it is we really truly need to understand our students. I took this as well as good old Pep Lau and the advisor fit model. So this is an example of using multiple theories to a situation. One of my students, we will call her Cecilia, is a first generation student. She is a transfer student that has come from a Division I school. She was one of the top athletes there, but she decided that she wanted to transfer to USM. She did not want to compete for personal reasons. So she came to USM, very excited about her academic program, really thought that it was providing her everything that she needed, was completely disengaged from school, like the community, had a high financial need, super supportive parents. But her parents, she was a first-gen student, so her parents really didn't know how to support her in a way that made sense because they didn't understand this. Remember that complicated organization we work in? They didn't understand. And she's a commuter. She would jump in her car, go to class, jump back in her car, and then cruise back unless she had an appointment with somebody like me. Where she could engage. But then she came in truly seeking, what the heck is my imagined future? Where am I going? What's happening? So I used this model here where I needed to gain some trust with the student and help myself to be there, she to see me, and for us to work together. But I also needed to know her enough to be able to balance that challenge and support. So by doing so, we developed a plan. Initially, I was very involved in developing that plan with her because she needed more support. But then when she was kind of getting it and understanding it, I didn't need to support her as much. But I needed to question her plan and kind of poke at it a little bit and challenge her a little bit and figure out where is she going, what's happening, what is a good question, let's reflect on this. So she went out and she owned the plan, doing some great informational interviewing, meeting with her faculty members. And what the end result was is that she became very engaged because of that conversation she was having with faculty members. She's now involved in the academic group for her major, and she's very bought into the place that has been supporting her. It wasn't just me. There was multiple people as she started conversing with people. It was just that she needed to be able to develop that plan and implement it herself. So there was that balance. She now, this is not a picture of her real brain, but she is very well on her road to completing her applications for graduate schools to become a neuroscientist. Yeah, very cool. So I ask you this question. How would you or how do you currently connect theory in your own professional practice? Okay, this is where you're supposed to talk a little bit. So we could either talk as a group or we could break up into small groups, depending on what your needs are at this point in time. Okay, either I wowed you or something. You have to help me out here. Yes, Adele.
I teach a group class, a group practicum, One of the premises of good group work is that we build a sense of belonging in a group for it to successfully hold the values of the group. And so we actually spend the first half of class as a psychoeducational group in which we generate a sense of trust and belonging. So we have to work at that process of creating belonging so that the values that are inherent in the learning process are expressed in the group. So the theory is Yalom's theory of group development, and we actually engage in that process as a class.
That's awesome. So what I was hearing you say is that Yalom's theory of group process was used to definitely create the group in a trusting, sharing way. And I'm repeating this for our distant learners so that they can actually hear what you said. And that has assisted in enriching the learning environment for all.
And we, between the leader and the group itself, worked to create a sense of belonging so that we could experience the value of belonging in a group for the learning process of the group leaders that were eventually going to go out and lead their own groups.
Thank you for that example. How about other folks?
Beth, can I sneak an example and a question in?
Yes.
At the same time?
Yes.
So maybe I'll start sort of with the question. I was thinking about how the theories that you're talking about, are a mix of levels. So some are theories of individual behavior and some are more theories of group dynamics or organizational dynamics. And so there's that, I don't know what the question is that's lurking there. It's not clear to me either. But maybe later you could make a comment about how do you navigate the bridge theory to practice when the theories are at these different levels mm-hmm. of analysis, basically. And then I'll use an example, which is I used to be a sociologist, and I used to study microhierarchies. And my whole professional life is about micro-hierarchies, you know. And I use you know, I'm not a professional sociologist anymore, but I use what I learned in my discipline all the time in my work. And I used to use it quite a bit in my teaching, not just teaching the theory to students, but using the theory in the classroom. So I see this, and I guess maybe later, if there's time, and if not, I'll catch up with you, to talk about those levels of analysis, because that's a complexity in what you're describing, that theory to practice, we have to navigate it.
Mm-hmm. I think you bring up a really good point around, specifically around, this is not new, but it's new at looking at it, and creating more or less an expectation that this happens, especially in student affairs. And what has happened in Kimball and Reason's research is that when they did interviews, or Kimball did the interviews of practitioners, the practitioners could talk about it, but then they kept on questioning themselves, like, am I giving the right answer? Am I giving the right answer? They learned about this in graduate school, but it was bringing it into their current life, much like the sociologist, which I don't know if you can never not be a sociologist once you're there, yeah. But the sociologist incorporating it into their new line of work. But it's almost like it's a forming stage, and depending on where people work or study, it depends on what the expectation is about bringing it in.
Well, if we're allowed to give examples and then ask questions, then
I'm going to do that too.
I got away with it.
That's all right. I was thinking, I mean, maybe it took some of us so long to answer your initial questions, not to put you on the spot, but to think, do we or how do we, or Beth's presentation is maybe making me think perhaps I should a little bit more than I do. So, I mean, as a historian, in that one lens, I think less about theory and more about method, but I don't know that it's so different. So I think in terms of my historical practice, I'm pretty well versed in the methods of being an historian. So I sort of live those and then don't really have to think about the theory as much anymore. But when I start something new, so in a new role, I think the way in which I connect theory to professional practice is I read the theory to sort of understand a new set of professional practices or methods, usually so I can work against them. typically, honestly, sort of getting the lay of the land to know where I'm in line with something or where I'm consciously breaking away from something, but also to make you sort of conversant in that field. So depending on the field that you're entering, a knowledge of the theory is often, I think, your ticket into that field. And you can only break away from and sort of form your own theories once people understand that you have a knowledge of what the theories are. So it's sort of like learning the rules to break them, I think, is how I connect theory to my professional practice. So, surprise. But the question in there is, and I'm really curious about this, how do you help people, and how did you find the theories that worked best for you as you were putting all of these things together?
Awesome question. I will. Do you want the honest answer?
Yeah.
Peplau was by accident. It was. It was truly by happenstance, and some of the best things in life, I believe, happened by happenstance. It was a group of friends and I needed to find a theory, and I set out a quest, and it was almost to talk about gamification. It was, let's have a game, and let's play find a theory. And I had like these mini researchers sitting around a table, and we were searching for theory around relationships. And there's not a lot that match what I was looking for. There's plenty of theories around mentorship and things like that, but I wanted to go deeper. So I think some of it is by happenstance, and some of it is by being in a formal classroom. And I mean, graduate school is a delightful thing where you get to learn about theory and figure out how is that going to fit into either what I'm doing or where I'm going. And the other piece is learning from others. So being around people that are sociologists, and higher education is a beautiful thing. But if you hang out with bankers, there's a whole different other segment of theory. And I'll tell you that it was the banker that found Peplau's relationship theory, relational theory. But it's very different depending on where, I believe, that where you are in life and where you're poking holes and exploring. And I also think that everybody has a mini knapsack of theories that they lean on. And I ask the students that I work with in classes, but also if we're working on a project together, that they carry those with them. And sometimes you throw them out, and sometimes you put new ones back in, and sometimes you take the old ones back and throw them in your knapsack. But I think it's an important way for practice. Yes.
Hi. Yes. Yeah. So first, I just want to thank you for the presentation. It was outstanding. Just a couple thoughts and reflections on the topic. Within the world of adult education, I would say that there's a lot of practitioners who do certain things in their classroom setting that are directly related to Mesro or Brookfield or other theorists, but they've never heard of those people. Mm-hmm. They just do them because that's what seems to be the natural thing to do. And I would just say, on a personal level, I look back on my own experience as a graduate student here, and one of the things that fascinated me was I would look at some of the theories that were being presented to me, and I would say, oh, so that's why I'm doing that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there was a little bit of the reverse engineering happening where you're doing something, and now you're learning about the theory to support what you've been doing. Mm-hmm. That's an interesting phenomena. The question for me is this. You know, when I look at, just Brookfield, for example, when he talks about sort of the practice of teaching is whitewater rafting, okay? And I think that theory is extremely important to practice, but I also recognize that there are times where the situation, let's say, in the classroom unravels. And there comes a point where there has to be a high level of improvisation. Mm-hmm. So my question is, where do you see the art of practice come into this formula? Thank you.
Yeah, that's another great question. I think it becomes natural, quite frankly. Mm-hmm. I think that theory is not something that you walk around with it, but you don't use it as a flag. Mm-hmm. And I think when you're using it as waving a flag, mm-hmm. then it's not the true purpose of theory. Mm-hmm. I believe the true purpose of theory is to help guide people and also to have you look at your practice to be able to maybe tweak it. So your reverse engineering is a really good example of you were probably doing a fantastic job and you didn't need to know that name of that theory to do this fantastic job in the classroom. But it probably informed you to be more self-confident about what you were doing. It was not just natural, it was actually, it has a name to it. So I think that there's a balance, much like that balance of challenge and support, where it's a science and an art that happens. It's more or less when an artist will mix up paint to create this landscape, sometimes they know exactly what they're doing with measurements, and sometimes they just do it. And you would know more about this being in a field of art, of artists in your home, but sometimes they do it in a natural way.
Well, that's just to know, my first professor here was Will Callender.
Yeah.
And it was program design, and I've never recovered. So yeah. I just want you to know that, okay?
With the spinning? Yeah.
So I have a question, or getting back to your original question. Mm-hmm. I teach HRD 631, which is all about theories. And I wish I knew you were doing this particular presentation, because I had a student a few weeks ago say, why do we have to learn all these theories? And, you know, how does it connect with my professional practice? I'm fortunate in that every week we're talking about many different theories. So it's a reflection on my part, like, you know, transformative learning. Mm-hmm. How does that fit in with the online course? So it's you know, one of the benefits of teaching a course like that is you're constantly refreshing your memory of the. Mm-hmm. But I had a question for you on the cone of learning. Yeah. So that was developed in late 60s, 69.
It's old.
Do you think it works?
Old like me.
How? I mean, you gave a really good example of how you've used that in your course. Do you think that works? This program's 100% online. Mm-hmm. Does it still work as well online as it did back in 69 when everything was in person? Mm.
You actually have probably identified a gap in the literature, my friend.
I'm dead. I'm not going back to school.
I think I honestly think I'm a product of online learning. I did all my doctorate through Northeastern as an online learner. I believe that I don't remember everything that I read. And I just reread something yesterday that I read very seriously a few weeks ago. And I was like, did I read this? So I think that there's some validity around that cone. But I would also say that as online facilitators of learning, we're more conscious of that, so that students start this engagement, that we create this community of learning in our classes. And in my particular course, I changed the group so that people don't get too comfortable in the same group. And there's this momentum behind it. And my hope, and Stacy could tell me, of whether or not what I try to do is to create this sense of responsibility for the whole. So a student feels responsible for not only their learning, but the responsibilities of others, and that there's this rich conversation that happens. What do you think, Stacy?
Yeah, I definitely enjoyed the, it was nice to, I mean, it was a summer class too, so it was 7 weeks. So it was, you know, you were very conscious of, you can't respond to everybody and read everything, so you're getting in these small groups, but then you switched them up so we could learn from one another and really get the most out of everything that you had to offer. And it was a lot of reading, but it was all very, very good reading. I don't think I've read as much advising material since becoming an advisor, so I really appreciated the class.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool, thanks. Do you remember everything you read?
No.
Okay, just checking.
Sorry.
Do we have any questions from our distance folks?
No, I would let you know.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks.
Sure.
It's more a question. I guess I can tie it to what we do. I mean, obviously, as you know, I advise our grad students here. So I think a lot of times when you're connecting theory to practice and being on the other side, as I always talk when you're going through this program, make sure you're communicating with your faculty so that you're putting your theories into practice. I think a lot of times what happens is that we compartmentalize. And as faculty members or anything else, be it sociology, be it history, be it whatever it is, we think we're just going to fit the theories of whatever we've been learned into what's going to best fit the needs of a student, where the truth is a lot of times it's a lot broader than that. You know what I mean? It's a lot more holistic. There comes that ability where it has to be, you're connecting the theories, but then there's life skills and other things that go into it and all the other things that you were talking about. My question, and kind of going off of that, and you know I'm a Mesereau person, and people in this room know that from our other interviews, is that we look at the accessibility. We look about then working together to come up with those plans and that exploration. It then has to happen with a faculty and adult learner that it really then comes where, okay, where is my role as the student to be able to know how this is going to impact my plan? So my question is, when you look at your background is in higher ed administration. This is a program. Not only is it online, so there's that artistic side too, the making sure that you're communicating with people. What about the people that come in from the different walks of life? Mm-hmm. How do you build that, not only connect the theory to practice, more importantly, how do you have that identifying relationship to realize that I'm not going to necessarily have the answers for them? I'm going to be teaching theories and hopefully building a relationship so that you can individualize your plan. But how do you overcome that when you deal with somebody who's a corporate trainer or as opposed to somebody from different walks of life that are still coming in through the program with a different outcome?
Mm-hmm. I think all those different types of people bring a richness to the classroom. Because if I only had academic advisors in that class, then that would be kind of boring. And it's the responsibility, I think, of the facilitator to know the students. So ensuring that knowledge of the student and then figuring out what are their needs so that I can help relate it and give the constant feedback. And it's okay if I don't know something to ask. Because just because you're the teacher or the facilitator does not mean that you know everything. And especially in graduate school, it's an opportunity for people to be the facilitators of learning, even if they're a student. And I would say that happens on the undergraduate level as well. That's it. Okay. Okay. Yeah, there is one more thing that I'd like to share with you, and that is this piece right here. So I would encourage us as educators to actually bring theory and the conversation around theory into everything that we do. So there is no problem with asking the question, really, how does that apply? How does theory apply to this? So, and you don't need to know what the theory is when you're asking the question. You could just ask the question. To give you an example, one of the areas in advising that we're working on right now is a career ladder for advisors, so that advisors don't have to leave advising to actually go and progress in their career. Part of that is that they need to provide new knowledge to the profession. So in the world that I work in right now, I have advisors that are really curious about, okay, how do I write? How do I create this new knowledge? So one advisor in particular was talking to me about her interests. And her interest was, I really, this transactional piece of my job, but then there's this relational piece of my job, and I want to write about it. I want to explore that and write about it. And I'm like, great. What theory are you going to use? And she goes, I'll get back to you on that. So she went away, and then probably 2 weeks later, she's like, Beth, I think I found my theory. I found two of them. And I said, great, what is it? And so she was talking about a leadership theory, and it was transactional leadership and relational leadership. And I said, okay, instead of just saying great, I said, can you give me some examples? I am not well versed in those theories. And she was able to give some examples of what that looks like in her everyday. And that's how you can create this conversation around theory. So what I truly appreciate in the workplace is really creating kind of a learning community in the workplace so that people can share their knowledge with each other and challenge each other. And I think that we can connect theory to our programs and workshops and anything that we're creating, whether we are in the corporate world, we're in adult educating world, or we're in a higher education world, or even if we are in the K through 12 world. I think that we can connect theory in varying ways to do that. And then as we are assessing our programs, we should talk about theory. This is a gap in my practice, is that I do not use theory, and we have an assessment team, and we don't really talk about a lot about theory in that assessment team, and that's something that I can actually bring back to my group. And then this just creating the conversation and consciously using theory as we are working through the problem solving, reflective practices and action and planning. And then expanding theory, commit to creating new knowledge. We do have a responsibility to help our areas of profession grow. How are we going to do that? Well, one way is to do research and start connecting that theory to what we do and helping others identify different ways of living, learning, and growing. So with that, I know that your time is precious, so I will end here, but I do want to say thank you very, very much for being here, and I truly do want to help this program grow and do great things. I also love USM, and I would love to be here to help this program do that. So I thank you.